The year was 1935, and Babe Ruth, the Bambino, the Sultan of SWAT, the King of Swing, the Colossus of Crash, had seen better days. Years of hard living and several automobile accidents had taken their toll, but the Babe could still draw a crowd, and the racially diverse spectators at the Dyckman Oval were his kind of people. On September 29, 1935, they came in droves. That sunny afternoon, an estimated 10,000 fans came to the 4,600-seat Dyckman Oval to see their hero play on a team of former All-Stars and minor leaguers in an exhibition game against the New York Cubans of the old Negro League. The price? 55 cents for the grandstands and $1.10 for the big spenders in the box seats. The game, for which Ruth was paid $3,000, would be one of his last. Amid the sea of fans, one lone reporter, Tom Meaney of the New York Telegram, realized the tragedy unfolding before his very eyes. The spectators seemed to sense that they were watching something pathetic. There were neither newsreel nor still cameras in evidence, and no telegraph keys clattered brassily in the press box, which had less than half a dozen occupants. No civic dignitaries, not even an alderman, could be observed in the crowd. Paid to play just the first game of the doubleheader, which the Cubans won 6-1, Ruth took to the plate between games to give the ticket holders a bit more bang for their buck. Over the next 5 minutes, Meaney and the 10,000 fans witnessed a piece of baseball history that would never be entered into the record books. As pitcher Clyde Barfoot hurled balls from the mound, the Babe, for a fleeting moment, sprung back to life, slamming ball after ball out of the park. Those in attendance swore one particular baseball was hit further than any in the previous history of the Dyckman Oval. But as Ruth faded into the stuff of legend, the Dyckman Oval was entering its heyday. When the Dyckman Oval first appeared in the sports pages towards the end of World War I, it was a homely affair located at West 204th Street and Nagel Avenue. In the early years, the Oval was used mainly for cricket matches and ice skating competitions. By 1921, the Oval was drawing baseball fans from all five boroughs and beyond, including Mayor John F. Hyland. That spring, Hyland made an impromptu visit to the Oval to see Jeff Tesoro's team battle the Cuban Stars. Not recognizing the mayor as he approached, a gateman demanded to see a ticket. "I haven't any," responded the mayor. "Well, you'd better get one if you want to see this game." Luckily for both parties, a manager spotted the mayor and escorted him into the Oval, where he immediately took to the mound. The mayor threw four pitches against the opposing team. Three of them were strikes. Soon boxing was added to the roster. Pugilism would become a staple of the Oval for years to come, but at the time, many doubted the Dyckman Oval could survive the Great Depression. By 1929, the Dyckman Oval played host to mainly soccer games. Lawsuits and years of poor management had left the once thriving facility on life support. It was not until 1935, the same year Ruth played his exhibition game, that things turned around for the Dyckman Oval. But first, a deal with the devil had to be made. Enter Harlem numbers broker Alejandro Pompez, who gave the ailing Dyckman Oval a $60,000 shot in the arm to use as a showcase for his prized baseball team, the New York Cubans. A 2003 Sports Illustrated article, written by Daniel Coyle, provides a wonderful description of Pompez. Pompez was a criminal in the eyes of the police, and a crown prince in the eyes of Harlemites. From his cigar store, the soft-spoken Cuban ran a numbers bank, a lottery that filled his pockets to the tune of $8,000 a day, which he used to fund his Negro League baseball team, the New York Cubans. Courtly, suave, and scrupulously honest with his clients, Pompez was beloved in Harlem for his civic generosity. All went swimmingly for him until an evening in 1931, when the Bronx-based gangster Arthur Flegenheimer, better known as Dutch Schultz, employed his .45-caliber revolver to persuade Pompez to hand over control of his numbers game. Needing another source of income, Pompez turned to sports enterprises. In 1935, he leased a vacant field at Dyckman Oval from the city and transformed it into one of the finest sports palaces in Manhattan. Pompez put his money to good use. Under his renovations, the Dyckman Oval was transformed into a shining new 10,000-seat arena with modern conveniences, like floodlights, for playing well into the night. A master showman, Pompez knew how to fill the house. If Babe Ruth didn't dazzle them, then perhaps a boxing exhibition with Joe Louis, a new car raffle, whatever it took. The Oval, often called Harlem's Own, was a melting pot where all New Yorkers could gather and simply enjoy a ball game. And Pompez's New York Cubans knew how to delight. Player, manager, Martin Digo was clearly a house favorite. Dubbed El Maestro by fans and sports writers alike, Digo could play all nine positions with equal skill. His lightning speed fastballs remain the stuff of legend. Often called the most versatile player in the history of baseball, the 6'3", 210-pound, right-handed Cuban would eventually be elected to the Mexican, Cuban, and American Halls of Fame. The entire team, comprised of Cuban, African-American, Puerto Rican, and Dominican players, proved a force to be reckoned with, even when playing against legendary teams like Satchel Paige and his Pittsburgh Crawfords. But the days of wine and roses couldn't last forever. The team's owner, Alex Pompez, was, after all, a career criminal. When rival gangsters gunned down Dutch Schultz in October of 1935, Pompez went back into the numbers rackets. The move would prove a serious miscalculation. In 1936, New York County District Attorney Thomas Dewey was preparing an indictment against Pompez for his involvement in the policy rackets. Receiving a tip, Pompez fled the country. When Mexican authorities arrested Pompez in 1937, he was traveling under the name Antonio Moreno. Federales in Mexico City nabbed baseball's greatest fugitive as he stepped into a bulletproof car with Chicago license plates. Pompez's legal difficulties would prove disastrous for his beloved franchise. While the Dyckman Oval would continue to host sporting events, the New York Cubans stopped playing altogether. In 1939, after providing lengthy testimony for the prosecution in return for a lenient sentence, Pompez pleaded guilty to conspiracy in return for a 2-year suspended sentence. When the Cubans were readmitted to the Negro National League in 1939, they would find themselves without a home. A year earlier, perhaps despite the admitted gangster, the city of New York demolished the Dyckman Oval and turned the grand old field into a parking lot. Today, the Dyckman housing projects sit on this once hallowed sporting ground. As for Pompez, he swore to stay on the straight and narrow. By all accounts, he did just that. In 1943, Pompez found a new home for the New York Cubans inside New York's famed Polo Grounds. Lacking fan support, the Cubans folded in 1950. Pompez went on to become a respected talent scout, who played a role in the signing of the great Willie Mays. He was also credited with opening baseball's Dominican pipeline. Pompez died in 1974. He was 83 years old. Pompez was elected to the National Baseball Hall of Fame in 2006.